July 11th, 2017, Wentworth Town Council meeting will now come to order. If everyone will please bow your head for invocation, please. Dear Lord, please be with us here tonight as we do the work of the town. Protect those that protect us both here and overseas, and be with the needy and those that need you the most. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Next item on the agenda is approval of the town council agenda. I don't see any additions over here, so I make a motion that we approve the agenda as written.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Not all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Next item on the agenda is approval of the minutes. Everybody has a copy there.
I make a motion that be accepted as written.
Second. I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is a public hearing for consideration of an ordinance of the town of Wentworth minimum housing standards. Call a public hearing to order. And who's helping?
Yes. Good evening, Board. What I have before you are the minimum housing standards. When we talked a couple months ago, we talked about turning the minimum housing standards for the county and turning that into something that Wentworth would use and indeed their own ordinance. So what you've got before you is the resolution and the actual minimum housing code turned into Fort Wentworth instead of Rockingham County. At that time, we didn't recommend any additional changes to that ordinance, but I know that legal has looked at it, so he's got some recommendations tonight for some addendums to it. So I'm sure Josh can go over those.
Sure. Pat asked me to look through it and identify some of the different potential issues that might come up. And of course, Tony will know better, I guess, based on how Rockingham County has been enforcing this. But one of the things that we looked at was that there's no grandfather clause or no safe harbor period. So based on the language looks like on the effective date, it says this ordinance shall become effective and be in full force on the date of its adoption. So it would go into effect immediately, and you know, again, this is just based on a strict reading. It would go into effect immediately and would require every dwelling in Wentworth to meet the currently applicable codes. And so we thought it might be a good idea to have some sort of a grandfather period or just do something so that a home that's been in compliance or hasn't had any issues wouldn't immediately be out of compliance.
Right, and generally how that works is if you've got a house that was built in 1982, whatever the code was expected of in 1982 is what the building standard would be, unless they add on or make changes, and any changes would need to come into compliance with the current code. We have books that go back to the beginning of time, it seems, so that should we have that, we've got the code that was active then. I can see where the minimum housing code doesn't really speak to that, but the North Carolina building code does.
Okay. So that might, may or may not be something that we actually need to...
And it wouldn't hurt either way. It's not going to hurt anything.
That was the first thing that we had looked at, was potentially some sort of a grandfather clause. Another thing was the relaxing the penalty for noncompliance. The ordinance says that the violation of any provision of this ordinance shall constitute a misdemeanor. And I don't think that's unusual. They cited to one of the general statutes where it says that that's pretty common for violation of a town ordinance. But we thought maybe... and again, this is it's probably enforced this way, but we thought maybe it would be a good idea to change the language to say, you know, it's not being in violation that constitutes a misdemeanor. It's being in violation and failing to correct it after being told that constitutes a misdemeanor. Again, that it would be fairly unreasonable to you know, just say, well, you're in violation, that's a misdemeanor, without giving somebody a chance to correct it. I'm sure that's not how they...
Right, the state building code, if you go as far as condemnation, not one thing that's not effective, but multiple things. The condemnation gives you a list of things that are out of compliance. You give the opportunity to repair said list. And there is sometimes a violation. If we go out and do, we did one today, we go out and post a property, condemn it, pull the power, we're going to give, you have the first 30 days to get that list, figure out what you can do with that list, and then you meet with us. There's a time frame that that whole process works out. So the misdemeanor, there's only two cases I've ever had that were misdemeanor related. We worked on them for 3 years each, and the owners just made no effort to come to compliance. They ended up at the courts. The judges put them on probation for one was a year, one was 2 years to get their stuff in order and get their properties straight. So it's an extreme measure for us to ever file anything. It's a lot of work for us too, but we would rather have the property or facility, whatever we're dealing with, come to compliance than do any kind of court measures.
Sure. So it kind of sounds like it's being interpreted very reasonably, and it's just whether council wants to go with the ordinance as written or maybe amend it so that it the actual language matches sort of the reasonable interpretation that they're giving it in practice. And that tends to be true for the rest of these. The notice provision, some of the definitions that we looked in there. Again, we're kind of just looking at the language to see if you interpreted it exactly as written, which sounds like they're much more reasonable than that. But if you interpreted it exactly as written there under number three, if you look at the language, dwelling would probably include a carport, a garage, maybe even a shed. Later on, it says you have to have electric lights in every dwelling. So they'd seem to be requiring that carports and garages and your shed would have to have electric lights. Again, I really doubt that's how it's enforced.
No, state building code won't want to enforce it that way. They define these things for you.
Okay. Okay.
And I think that's where they based this off years ago. They pulled from state building code without quoting it, saying that they pulled from it.
Okay.
And that's, like you said, it's neither here nor there. It's already excluded, so it's up. If they want more of an exclusion, that's fine too.
Okay. I think that's probably true for the rest of these, except maybe the timeline for making appeals. I don't know that a lot of people do that. That we had as number six. And that's just a 10-day time for someone to appeal it. We thought maybe give folks a few more days because they are allowed to have an attorney, and sometimes it's difficult to find an attorney within 10 days. I don't know if it's in...
We've actually had that building code since the late, or the minimum housing code since the late 90s, and we've never had an appeal. So I wouldn't say we're as reasonable, not we never had to use it. Because usually when it gets to something this far, it becomes more of a public health safety issue. I mean, the situation we were in today was a lady was being eaten alive by the roaches in her house. Hmm. So that was beyond just building that. Social services has to step in and help provide them a safe place to be. So that 10-day thing, we work with people, and she likely will be able to get that home back where it needs to be within 30, 60 days. It's not terrible, the building's not terrible, but we gave the list, and the 10 days could apply, but we like to work with people as long as they can.
Okay, and I guess the last thing that we kind of looked at was under number seven, when property has been identified as requiring repair or maybe even demolishment, it looks like, again, this is just looking at the language, just the words themselves, if the repair can be made at a cost less than 50% of the property's value, then you're allowed to repair it. But if it can't be made in the order from the building inspector, if it's less than 50%, he would order them to repair it. If it's greater than 50%, he'd order them to demolish it. And we thought there might be folks who are willing to pay more to repair it, or who don't want to pay, you know, they, I guess, wouldn't be willing to pay, even if it wouldn't cost less than the 50%. Thought maybe we could give people a little bit more choice. Again, I would imagine that that's probably, that they don't stick with that formula in practice.
I mean, it depends on, if you've got a foundation problem and even just structural underneath the house, that usually is more than 50%. But we never cut them off at 50%. I know it's in there. And I have to take a severe situation, I guess. But we give the list. They get the estimates of the cost. We don't know what things cost. We know what it means by building code. And if they can do it, and they will repair it, we'll turn the power back on. And that's, like I said, it's person by person. 20 years from now, you might have somebody interpreting it a little bit different. But as the current staff, it's, we want to give people every opportunity to stay in the houses.
Absolutely. So those were the issues that we identified. And it sounds like they're all addressed very reasonably right now. And it just sort of comes down to whether the council would like to have us revise the language to match sort of the reasonable, I guess, practice that is currently being utilized, or if we're comfortable adopting the language as it currently is based on the practices that the county is using right now.
I'm comfortable with the idea of adding a grandfather clause. And again, I don't think it, Tommy, I don't think it makes much of a difference either way, but I like the idea of that.
All of these are totally up to y'all's discretion. It's not going to abolish what you're trying to accomplish, but this is fine with me.
Okay. Under that, what's the safe harbor period under grandfather clause?
30 days.
Oh, yeah.
And as far as the misdemeanor charge goes, I guess my concern would be, I feel like the planning staff now are very flexible, but what if down the road, 10 or 20 years from now, that were to change? And I think when we started this process, one of the things that we initially wanted to do was make this less cumbersome, or as less the least cumbersome as we could. And so I don't want people to get charged with a class 3 misdemeanor right off the bat. And I know your staff isn't going to do that.
No, and even if the minimum housing code doesn't have that, building code, which, let's go a little further before they do that, state law allows for that and requires it in some situations depending on whose health is at risk and all that.
Okay, so we're talking about a unit that were, you know, potential environmental hazard to neighbors.
And either to themselves or if they have children in the home or something like that, that the building code has that out as well. Your minimum housing code doesn't have to have it because that's
fair. Okay. Well, that's in the general state statute.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like I said,
so that's not a matter of what ours says anyway.
Yeah, when we pursued for years and years and can't get any results, that's the only time we use it.
Yeah. So do y'all think we need to
put something in there?
I'm having a grandfather clause. I was reading over it, and this is kind of off the grid just a little bit here, so bear with me.
People
just don't have no money to fix your place up.
I've solved logs a lot. Cypress logs and things like that to build log cabins with and things like that. And, of course, I know you have to have proper sewage and have to have water out there, potable water. But when it comes to electricity, I mean, you have to have some electricity there to pump your water. But the lights, that just, I mean, it's not something I want to change, but it just, It just kind of bothers me that you can't go out here and build a log cabin like one used to be, and yeah, put chandeliers and the old lamps and stuff around it that you've got to have lights in. I mean, would they pass that? I mean, if you went in, you had your septic system in, and you had your water system in, and you said, I don't want lights in the house. Yeah, I don't want to pay for lights in the house. I'm going to put, you know, I'm going to use chandeliers and oil lamps and stuff like that. I mean,
I'm going to say no, because you can't have the flammable stuff inside a dwelling, and that's state building code. That's not normal.
How about outdoor jumps? Have they done away completely with them?
As an everyday use, yes. For events or things that are used on very irregular basis, you can use those things.
But there's a lot of places you can't have water, so I was just wondering.
So, well, that's for anything new. If there's an existing situation, like this said, you're going to have a certain code from way back when, and that's okay. Until you start changing stuff, we're not going to say anything.
So when we're burning an oil lamp when it powers out, we're breaking code there because we have a flammable
item. Officially, I guess I would have to say yes, but nobody's going to come out and turn it off for you. We had a lot of that during the thunderstorms.
Yeah, I put on my oil lamp every time it comes up a storm.
What do you do? There's nothing.
What would you have to do in order to do that? I mean, you'd have to have something that just say not, you don't comply at all, and you say, I don't live here, I just go out there and camp out in it or something like that.
If it's permitted as a inhabitable structure, commercial, residential, whatever, then that's when it falls in the code. If it's an accessory building or something that you wouldn't allow habitation of, it doesn't count.
So much for the good old days, huh?
Yeah. That would be primitive camping, and we do have some districts that allow that.
Primitive camp.
That's what we call that.
Okay.
Yeah. That's like where you don't have the electrical hookup to the sewer
or whatever.
You just show up with a tent and whatever else you think you need.
Or the cabin. Okay. Sorry that I went off on that little tangent there. I don't have a problem with the grandfather clause. So much we can do about the non-compliance. So state statute. I do kind of feel like it is tight finding an attorney. If at some point in time somebody did hold somebody to the 10 days, that's kind of tough. Some people may take them a little bit of time to come up with the money to get an attorney.
Right, in these kind of situations, you're right on with that. Yeah.
Well, they could have a court-appointed attorney. It's state-initiated.
Yeah, they do you a whole lot of good most of the time.
Well, I know, but I'm just... Yeah.
Okay. All right, well, does anybody other than... adding the grandfather clause... Anybody want to put anything else in there? Do we want to give them 30 days on their attorney as far as a time for making appeal? How do y'all feel about it? Any way, one way or the other?
I don't think 10 days is long enough or something.
I'm fine with extending that. Are y'all, Cheryl, ours? Longer than 10 days?
Okay. Can we vote on it with those amendments, or do we have to need it written up beforehand? Or
Pat said that you could go either way if you'd like to look at the final draft after we've revised it. We could do it next month, or if you'd like, you could vote and in the motion
add the amendment. Pat knows we like to fly by the seat of our pants anyway.
George has done a great job putting the memo together, so it makes it very clear on what you're adopting.
I had
to. Okay. All right, and so there's no more discussion. I'm going to move out of the public hearing so we can vote on this. call the public hearing to a close. I would like to make a motion that we, this isn't one of those where I have to read all this stuff with, is it? No, I don't think so. I'd like to make a motion that we approve the ordinance of the town of Wentworth minimum housing standards to be amended under number one of our memorandum for the grandfather clause, and number six on relaxing the time for making appeals for those two amendments. Is that okay if I get a second on it?
Wait,
flip so.
Did we set a time?
30 days.
30 days.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes, what's in there?
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
So we can give, we can entertain a second?
Yeah.
Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
I just have one question in the actual ordinance, or maybe more than one, but about the heating system. Is that just speaking to central heating systems if the, on page four at the bottom, does that just speak to central heating systems? In other words, as I read it, I don't think it's necessarily requiring a central heating system. It's just speaking to the nature of a central heating system. Yeah,
that's the way I read it.
Right, it's not requiring it. Now, you are required to have heat in any habitable right. structure, but it doesn't necessarily require a central heating
okay.
for any structure.
And it has to maintain the temperature of 68 degrees, so it's defunct and needs to be repaired. You're technically in violation of the minimum housing code. But nobody's going
really
to know unless you report yourself.
Yeah. You can just turn it up a couple of degrees.
Exactly.
It won't up 68.
All right. That's, I'm good.
You're good? Okay. We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Not all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Thank you, guys. Next item under old business, item six, consideration of an ordinance of the town of Wentworth adopting changes to the Wentworth planning and zoning ordinances to update language and clarify regulations and requirements for parades and special events. Second reading. And we've looked over this one time. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
This includes the changes we suggested, correct?
Yes, it does. It covers what you all approved last time, and we added language in to cover other governmental spots and locations. All that's included.
Questions? If not, I move that we approve the amendment of permit regulations for parades and special events. The town council approves the ordinance text amendments before it and adopts the following statements as required by NCGS 160A-382B and 160A-383. The council's action in adopting these text amendments is consistent with the adopted comprehensive plan because the board has determined that the zoning amendments are consistent with the Wentworth land use plan and other comprehensive plans because the land use plan recommended that a detailed review of existing ordinances be completed and corresponding changes be made in the ordinance that are consistent with the plan. The land use plan recommends that existing policies be revised and new policies be considered. Proposed amendment follows this recommendation. The land use plan recommends that existing ordinances be revised and new ordinances be considered. The proposed amendment allows this recommendation. additional comments concerning consistency with a comprehensive plan. We don't have any. The council considers its action in adopting the proposed text amendments to be reasonable and in the public interest because, A, it is reasonable and in the public interest to amend the Wentworth Planning and Zoning Ordinance to provide current permitting requirements that makes the planning and zoning ordinance easier for the public to use and understand. All right. Can I get a second on that? I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Not all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. All right. And the next item on the agenda is a closed session. Article 7 pursuant to NCGS 143-318.11A3 to consult with attorney in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the attorney and the town and pursuant to NCGS 143-318.11A5 to establish or instruct the public body staff or negotiating agents concerning the position to be taken by or on behalf of the public body in negotiating the price and other material terms of a contract or proposed contract for the acquisition of real property by purchase, option, exchange, or lease. The property is located at 591 NC 65 in Wentworth, North Carolina, and is owned by Rockingham County. The property is intended to be used for recreational and historical preservation. And I think we'll move into for closed session.
You have to make a motion to move into closed session.
Okay, I know, but I was just wondering, do y'all want to move over there? Okay, all right. I'll make a motion that we move into closed session in the other room over there.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Okay. There'll be, I make a motion that we have a 5-minute recess while we move around.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 We're just going to make this here.
Okay. I'll call the open meeting back to order. And I guess I'll just go ahead and make the motion. To accept the ECS proposal number 49.5971 and 5972-P for environmental testing at 591 NC 65 in Wentworth. Can I get a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Not all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Do I need to do something different?
Frankie had said that we could include the price in the motion if we want to.
Okay. I amend my motion to include the price of...
Yvonne
has it.
$12,900.
$12,900.
We'll leave it at that because it's in there.
Okay. Motion stands amended. Can I get a second? Got a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
I'm sorry. Who seconded? I didn't hear
that. That's okay. Next item on the agenda under new business is consideration of a budget amendment number one for fiscal year 2017-2018. Yvonne?
Okay, the first budget amendment for the year reflects the transfer of funds needed for an assessment of property located at 591 NC 65 in Wentworth. The attached budget amendment shows no change in the general fund revenues. It does show a change in general fund expenditures. It will show an increase of $13,000 in capital outlay property acquisition, and a decrease in of $13,000 in other operating costs, miscellaneous other operating costs. the general fund total budget dollars remain unchanged.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions? Now I make a motion that we approve budget amendment number one for fiscal year 2017-2018.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. The next item under new business is B, consideration of agreement with Dan River Water Incorporated to install a water line at the intersection of Peachtree Road and NC 8765. Everybody has a copy there. We've talked about that before. Are there any questions?
I thought they'd already put that in. The line? They hadn't put that line in?
Well, I don't think they have.
They've approved the project, but they haven't started.
Yeah, they're waiting for us to approve our end of it. Okay. So. If there are no questions, I make a motion that we approve the agreement with Dan River Water to install the water line at the intersection of Peachtree Road and NC 8765.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Under item C, consideration of increasing the council monthly stipend for the council members. That does not include me because I'm already getting more than y'all are anyway. We looked around and comparable size town would have been, I think it was Madan, was 150, and we decided to bring that before you and see if you wanted to approve raising the monthly stipend for council members to $150 a month. Is there any questions? Not, I make that motion.
A second.
Have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Motion carried. Next thing on the agenda is public comments, which we didn't have anybody signed up for. And I'll move on to the announcements. Let me get this big one first before I miss it. Wentworth Town Council meeting agenda, July 11, 2017. Candidate filing for the 2017 municipal elections begin Friday, July 7th, and ends on Friday, July 21st at 12 p.m. For more information, contact the Board of Elections at 336-342-8110. And that once again is July 7th through July 21st at 12 p.m. We'll move on to the other announcements. The next regular meeting of the Wentworth Planning Board will be held on Tuesday, July 18th, 2017 at 7 p.m. in the Town Hall Council Chambers. The next regular meeting of the Wentworth Town Council will be held on Tuesday, August 1st, 2017 at 7 p.m. in the Town Hall Council Chambers. For no further announcements, I make a motion we adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
The meeting stands adjourned. Thank you guys for coming out.